Hello, everybody. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Is it full screen now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, should we start? It's already 4:15. So I think this was the slide we stopped in last class yesterday. So let's move on from now. Just one second. Let me move this screen away. Okay. So this was the point, mobile charges, we stopped yesterday. Move on. Now we are going to the core of MOSFET modeling. The very important and the most important assumption, in my opinion, is known as charge sheet approximation. In charge sheet approximation, what we do is we assume that the inversion layer is an extremely thin sheet of charge with negligible potential dropped across it. Remember last class yesterday, we talked about surface potential psi s. And psi s has actually two parts. One part of that is dropped across the inversion layer, and the other part is dropped across the depletion layer. The sum of these two is equal to psi s. That makes physical analysis and modeling very, very difficult, because the physics of the inversion layer, which are electron sheet charge, and the depletion layer, which are immobile ions, are quite different. Therefore, to make a closed form solution of the device physics, etc., becomes extremely tedious and almost impossible to do by hand. Even for computer, for that matter, it becomes very difficult. So the very basic assumption we make is we do charge sheet assumption, which is short formed as CSA. In charge sheet assumption, we assume that the inversion layer is an extremely thin sheet of charge. Now, if it is so, then by Gauss law, we know that the potential dropped across it will be negligible. That is, if delta T vanishes, then delta V also vanishes, where delta V is a drop across that layer, delta T. Are following me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, if in any point you feel lost or something, you stop me and ask questions, okay? You can turn your mics on, no problem, provided there is no background noise. It disturbs everybody. So if I neglect the drop in the inversion layer, then the consequence of that is the entire surface potential psi s is assumed to drop across the depletion layer. This is a beautiful inference which comes out from the charge sheet assumption, that we assume that the entire surface potential psi s is dropped across the depletion layer. Keep in mind, we'll be using that a little later. Slide 19, voltage convention. This is another very important slide. There are two conventions used in MOS modeling. One is called source referenced. See, it is a four terminal device: drain, source, gate, and body. Therefore, I can make any of these terminals as my reference to determine the potentials, voltage. I have a choice of drain, I have a choice of source, choice of gate, and choice of body. Drain and source reference, of course, drain and gate reference are not used. What we use are two references. One is source and the other is body. And that gives two different models. One is called a source referenced model and the other one is called a body referenced model. Both are immensely popular and widely used, and each of them has some specific advantages. In source referenced model, all voltages are referred with respect to source, because as the name suggests, it is source referenced. So all voltages refer to source, which means we have three potentials, VGS, which we call gate source voltage, VDS, drain source voltage, and VBS, body source voltage. This is the most popular one, and I think all of you have been exposed to when you took circuit course, the model used for MOSFET are all source referenced. The expression of VT I gave yesterday was source referenced, as I said. It is most popular model, but asymmetric. That is, if I use the same model and switch drain and source, yesterday another issue came that MOSFET, some of you said MOSFET is a symmetric device. So if I take a cut line at the middle, then the left-hand side terminal can be either source or drain, doesn't matter. Similarly, the right-hand terminal can switch accordingly because it is a symmetric device. I can throw a small question. Suppose I'm an N-channel MOSFET, because all of you have background on MOSFET. Because without question, it becomes very dull if I keep on talking. So questions also keep you awake and interested in what's going on. And also think with me, because you don't know when the question is going to come. The symmetry thing, which we talked about, that if I take a cut line in the middle of the channel, then the left and the right look same. Then how do I know which terminal is source and which terminal is drain?
Which terminal is given the higher potential?
Super, absolutely. For N-channel MOSFET, the terminal which is given a higher potential is?
The drain.
Drain. Super. Very good concept, absolutely. So when I put one of the terminal higher than the other, automatically it becomes a drain. And if I switch terminals, that becomes source, isn't it? Yes, that is what is the meaning of symmetry. Source reference model is asymmetric for obvious reason, because everything I'm referring with respect to source. After I do that, I cannot interchange terminals. Therefore, source reference models are not used in digital application. Because in digital application, MOSFETs are typically used as a bi-directional switch. And when I use as a bi-directional switch, that is signal flows equally well from left to right or right to left, then I don't have a source defined, right? Have you gone through pass gates?
Yes, sir.
Pass gate switch, digital switch, etc. A simple example is a single transistor memory, where you have a MOSFET with a capacitor and you charge and discharge. So source and drain keep on changing depending on which is at a higher potential. The other one is body referenced, and where all voltages are referred with respect to body. This is a very, very robust model, mathematically very complicated, therefore people don't use it. And the terminal has switched, that the reference terminal has switched from source to body. So the voltages which we have, we define that as VGB, VDB, and VSB. VGB is gate body voltage, VDB is drain body voltage, and VSB is source body voltage. And once I do that, once my reference goes to body, then obviously the model becomes symmetric. And obviously this is very robust. Charge-based model are typically body referenced. We'll be talking about that as we go on. Right now, it will not make much sense. Slide 20. Now we are trying to formulate the model. So this is a very simple schematic of a two-terminal structure where you have got metal oxide semiconductor. The thick black band you see is called ohmic contact. What is ohmic contact, by the way?
The contact allows both the carrier in both the directions current can flow.
VI relation is linear.
Yes. Both answers are correct.
Metal semiconductor contacts.
Pardon me?
Metal semiconductor contacts that follow the Ohm's law.
What is the counterpart of ohmic contact?
Schottky contact.
Schottky barriers.
Rectifying contact. Absolutely.
Rectifying contact.
Rectifying contact, ohmic contact. A Schottky barrier diode can be a rectifying or an ohmic, right? Depending on your doping. If I make the doping very high, then tunneling will take place. It becomes an ohmic contact. Another very interesting answer came is that VI relation is linear. Do you agree? Current voltage relation is linear. Do you agree?
Yes.
Now,
I'm putting a question again. Suppose I'm plotting it, my V in the x-axis, voltage in the x-axis, and current in the y-axis. Problem clear?
Yes, sir.
V is x and I is y. Now I want to put the characteristic of an ohmic contact in this 2D sheet. How will it look?
Linear, sir.
Yes, yes, of course. But I can draw infinite number of straight lines in that sheet, right? Which one will it be? Okay, let me make the question more specific. Suppose I say the ohmic contact is ideal. If I say the ohmic contact is ideal, then what will be the IV plot?
The line will pass through the origin.
IV plot, I'm asking. Because you said linear, so it will be a straight line.
Yeah.
It will pass through origin, correct. Without any voltage, no current can flow. So V equal to zero, I equal to zero. Perfect, with origin. But now if the ohmic contact is ideal, then how will the characteristic look?
It's one slope, sir. Slope is one.
Ideal ohmic contact. The ohmic contact is ideal. Very simple question.
Like a superconductor.
No. Okay.
The ratio between V and I will be
extremely small resistance. Okay. Not superconductor. Okay. You guys are quite smart. Yeah. Don't put words in my mouth. Okay. I never said superconductor. I said ideal ohmic contact. And for an electrical engineer, any ohmic contact which has a resistance less than milliohm is an ideal ohmic contact. I'm asking how will the characteristic look? Anyway, let us not make a big fuss out of it. If I say the characteristic of an ideal ohmic contact is actually the y-axis, do you agree?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Y-axis is my ideal ohmic contact characteristic. So if it's a non-ideal ohmic contact, what will happen to that line?
With some finite slope.
It will move around?
The y.
It will shift around the origin? What does the slope dictate?
Resistance.
Conductance, actually.
Conductance.
Yes, so that is resistance. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So I have connected my body terminal to ground. That thick black band is ohmic contact. We're assuming nothing is happening there, a zero drop, and it is connected to ground. And on the gate, I'm applying a voltage, VGB. VGB implies gate body voltage. Potential is scalar. So whenever I write VXY, that means it's potential of terminal X with respect to terminal Y. Here, VGB means gate voltage with respect to body, and body being ground, VGB is same as VG, right?
Yes, sir.
Now, if I write see how the potential is dropping, because potential has to drop, whatever potential I apply has to drop in the device, cannot be in excess. So I see three regions it drops. Metal is equipotential, so there is no drop there. Then I have a drop in the oxide. Very interesting. The potential, the red line in the bottom curve, is a straight line. What does it tell you, by the way?
The electric field is constant within the oxide.
Wow, brilliant. And which way?
Metal to semiconductor.
Perfect. Because negative gradient is field, right? Negative gradient is field. So, and then semiconductor. And the semiconductor, the total potential dropped is psi s, which is surface band bending. Because that is the total amount of band bending which we have in the semiconductor, which we have psi s. And the rest of the applied potential drops in the contact drop between the metal and semiconductor because of the work function difference, phi s. So these are the three areas which the potential drops. One is the oxide drops psi ox, one is the semiconductor drops psi s, and finally the work function difference between metal and semiconductor, which is phi s. That gives us slide 21, basic equations of MOSFET. Understand it very well, because these equations are generic equation and these are valid for any novel device you conceive. This has to be followed because there are two things which are conserved in the world, in the nature. One is the potential, the other is charge. So potential is a conserved quantity, so is charge. And of course the fallout is power is also a conserved quantity. This MOSFET modeling is based on five basic and fundamental equations. The very first one is called potential balance equation. my equation, my potential of the structure must be balanced. And from the diagram, it is obvious that VGB, the gate body voltage, will be equal to psi ox plus psi s plus psi ms. This is a golden equation, by the way. This is known as potential balance equation. Oxide drop plus semiconductor drop plus contact potential equal to applied voltage. And psi ox is potential drop across oxide. Other two terms we already know. From this, we arrive at the next equation, which is known as incremental potential balance equation. What does it mean? Incremental potential balance equation means I perturb VGB by a small change. We call it delta VGB. And see how that reflects into the overall system. And I've written that expression as delta VGB equal to delta psi ox plus delta psi s. How come I did not write delta phi ms?
This constant quantity, it will not change.
It's a constant quantity.
Phi ms is phi m minus phi s. That has nothing to do with bias. Do you agree?
Yes.
Yes. Very good. Next one is charge balance equation, slide 22. This is very interesting also. The total charge in the system is conserved. What are the different charges? Oxide, MOSFET full of charges. You have got gate charge, you have got oxide charge, you have got inversion charge, you have got depletion charge. And all are expressed per unit area. So Q, this prime sign, I'm very particular about the notation, because if you write the right notation, you are writing the right equation also. Okay? So QG prime is gate charge per unit area, QOX prime is oxide charge per unit area, QI prime is inversion charge per unit area, and QB prime is depletion charge per unit area, all are per unit area. And some of these charges are zero, which means all cannot be positive, all cannot be negative, isn't it? Maybe you didn't get what I said. I said all the terms cannot be positive, nor can it be negative. Do you agree?
Sir. Yes, sir.
That means there is a compensation taking place. There is some positive charge compensated by some negative charge, right? Yes, like sir. For example, here in this equation, you can clearly see that if when the NMOS or N-channel MOSFET goes in inversion, then my QI prime, QB prime is negative and QG prime is positive. Just hold on a minute, please. Sorry about that. We are living in a very noisy environment. You can hear a lot of noise going on. Construction. Country is moving ahead, right? They say when lots of construction goes on, country is moving ahead. I hope we are. Incremental charge balance equation is a difference again. Just like from potential balance equation, we went to incremental potential balance equation. From charge balance equation, we can also write incremental charge balance equation. That is, if I change QG prime by a small amount, delta QG prime, how does it reflect on the system? Here also, I have taken QI prime on QB prime on the other side, put a minus sign in front and put delta in front of both. That means incremental gate charge is compensated by incremental inversion charge and incremental depletion charge. But again, I did not write delta QOX prime. Why? I know the answer because it is constant, absolutely. Note that in potential balance equation, phi ms was constant, and in charge balance equation, QOX prime is constant. And when you take them together, what do you get?
Capacitance, gate capacitance.
Yes. But these two components individually contribute to another parameter, which is a constant. Well, it is a tricky question, because, I'm doing this for a long time, so things are obvious, but not to you, obviously. For some of you, maybe, but not for all.
Flat.
Yes, absolutely. Flat band voltage. Beautiful. Because flat band voltage is phi ms minus QOX prime by COX prime. These two constant quantities are clubbed together to get your flat band voltage. Brilliant. And the final, we are already got four. Potential balance, incremental potential balance, charge balance, incremental charge balance. Fifth equation is Gauss law. fundamental law. Like you have a gate charge on top, on the metal gate, you have a gate charge QG prime. The oxide capacitance per unit area is COX prime, and PsiOx is the potential drop. As I said in the class yesterday, that MOSFET is nothing but a capacitor. Always, always remember that. As a matter of fact, any field effect device for that matter is a capacitor. Do you agree? Field effect device has to be a capacitor. Otherwise, how will I create field effect? Field effect means electric field. How will I create field effect unless it is a capacitor? So Gauss law tells you whatever charge I put on the gate, it must, this is equal to Q equal to CV equation. Q equal to C times V. Very fundamental equation, isn't it? So this C will be the oxide capacitance, COX prime, and oxide drop, PsiOx. You can prove it very easily, but I'll leave it as an exercise for you. Why don't you do that? So I have 6 variables and 5 equations, and now we are stuck. Now we are getting to see what are the bottlenecks in MOS modeling. And this is one of the biggest bottleneck, that I cannot do a unique solution. I have 6 variables and I have 5 equations. So what I can do is I can eliminate 4 to get a relation between the other two. And the first thing people thought about is, why don't I get a relation between PsiS and VGB? Because eventually I know PsiS is the thing which is the most important, and VGB is the controlling parameter. VGB is the gate body voltage under my control, user control. And if I know the effect of that VGB on the surface potential, I can model my charge in terms of surface potential. And if I know that, I get capacitance and current. Do you see the logic?
Can you sir, repeat again?
Okay, no problem. What I'm saying, that VGB is under my control as a user control, because I can change VGB. And I know my current and capacitance is a function of charge. And charge is a function of surface potential. So if I know the relation between surface potential and VGB, then one of the bottleneck or the problem is over. However, what we ended up with is a non-analytical equation, which is written there. VGB equal to VFB plus PsiS plus gamma square root of PsiS plus phi t exponential PsiS minus 2 phi by phi t. As I said, I'm not going to give you long derivations. Any standard textbook has this derivation, because if I want to give derivation, the whole flavor of this course will be lost. This basically comes from your fundamental 5 equations. And the 6 variables, if you eliminate and keep only PsiS and VGB, you eliminate QB prime, QI prime, PhiMS, and all these things, then you will end up with this relation. This relation, when it was first developed, it was non-analytical. And you won't believe, even today, it is non-analytical. And so many people worked over the years to make it analytical. Some of them succeeded to a large extent. Even initial part of my career, when I was working in MOS modeling, I also tried to, you know, better this model and make it analytical. You can do it piecewise analytical. Yes, of course. You can take weak inversion, make it analytical. You can take strong inversion, make it analytical. But what happens in the moderate inversion? It's very, very difficult. So you have to use interpolation function. Interpolation function will smooth out the variation in the weak inversion and the strong inversion region, and you get a smooth contour. So this one is still bothering people, by the way, and people are still trying to find out if I can have a single piece analytical approximation. This is not analytical. By the way, you have very good background in maths, I'm sure. This equation I'm saying to be transcendental equation, and it cannot be solved analytically and has to be evaluated numerically. Just by looking at this equation, do I know it is transcendental?
Yes, sir, because PsiS is a function of VGB already.
Okay. What special feature this equation has, which is telling me straight away it is a transcendental equation and I cannot have analytical solution? What feature? That is what I was asking. You must have done it in either plus 2, that is 11, 12, or first year, second year maths course in your engineering. the basic properties of transcendental equation? No, you haven't done?
Sir, we have exponential under the square root.
And no, that is not a problem. Exponential under the square root is not a problem, but something more.
Sir, psi s under exponential.
Okay. Carry on.
Because we have to establish a relation between VGB and psi s, but psi s is under the exponential. So it is a transcendental equation.
I'm almost there. Yeah, a little bit left. I'm filling it up. If I look at an equation and it has x and polynomials of x, which I already have, I have psi s, I have root psi s, and also I have exponential psi s. This equation cannot be solved analytically. If I have a polynomial in a variable and the same variable appears in the equation either in log form, ln form, or exponential form, this equation is analytically even not solvable today. And we say we are an advanced scientific community. Tell me about it. We cannot even solve a transcendental equation. If you could do, MOS modeling would have been so easy, because this is the biggest bottleneck, solving this equation. Because whenever you want to solve a transcendental equation, what is interesting is, see, my students are very tricky. What they do, if I go from left to right, that is, if I give you the value of VGB and tell you to find the value of psi s, the only way I can find it through iteration. Do you agree?
Yes.
However, I know what is the value of psi s. Do I?
Yes.
Do I know the range of values of psi s?
Yes, sir.
What are they? I cannot hear you. A little louder, please. Hello?
मीटिंग अटेंड करी है कमिश्नर साहब के साथ सही में डीएम साहब ने कॉलेज कर आपकी बहुत तारीफ की
maybe he is talking with somebody else no what I am asking what is the range of psi s minimum and maximum
sir minimum maximum would be conduction band value valence band value
Yes, psi s is band bending.
It's 0 to 2πf.
0 to?
2πf.
Okay, 2πf plus nt phi t, right? And we already know what is the value of 2πf plus nt phi t, which is about roughly 0.9 volt. Yesterday we talked about
sir.
It.
Yes, sir.
That means my range of psi s is 0 to 0.9 volt, very tiny range.
Yes.
So you know what these cheeky students do? They plug in the values of psi s and get VGB for that value. And they plot it and show it to me and say, ho gaya sir. I mean, this is unbelievable. Don't you think so? No, just joking. They don't do that. But you can. I mean, because this equation is right to left transcendental, but left to right is transcendental, but right to left is analytical. And as a matter of fact, people did think about that because psi s is a term which is quite well known, the range. Therefore, I can get the values of VGB and plot a beautiful plot. However, when you know VGB and you want to extract psi s, you have to go through iterations. And it is one of the biggest numerical bottleneck in analytical modeling of MOSFET. And people are still trying to find a way out. All right. Okay. Now move to 24. These boxes are actually... didn't come all right. This is actually much less than. It came as a box, I don't know why, maybe software incompatibility or something. For psi s, much less than 2πf, I can throw out that exponential term and I get VFP plus psi s plus gamma root psi s. Can you see it as an analytical equation? It is a quadratic equation in psi s, right? So, since it is defined two boundaries, one between depletion and weak inversion when psi s equal to phi f, and we call that VLB, which is VGB at psi s equal to phi f, which is VFP plus phi f plus gamma root phi f. and psi s equal to 2 phi f is the boundary between weak inversion and moderate inversion. And VMB is another term he defined, VGB. I'm defining these terms because I'll be showing you a plot and where how psi s changes with these voltages. If you're not too keen about following this mathematics, doesn't matter. It is just the first equation, VGB equal to VMB plus psi s plus gamma root psi s by throwing out the exponential term. And then what I'm doing, I'm plugging psi s equal to phi f in one case and psi s equal to 2 phi f in another case. Because from the chart I gave you yesterday, you know that phi f is the boundary between depletion and weak inversion. I some of you may not remember, but I'm telling you, because when psi s becomes phi f, EI touches EF at interface. So it is the boundary between depletion and weak inversion, and psi s equal to 2 phi f is boundary between weak inversion and moderate inversion. And then 2 phi f plus phi 0 will be the boundary between moderate inversion and strong inversion. 2 phi f plus nt phi t rather. Sorry, 2 phi f plus nt phi t will be the boundary between moderate inversion and strong inversion. Can I plug in that particular term in the above equation for VGB, this equation for VGB, and find something called VHB? I put psi s equal to phi f in this equation and got this VLB. I put psi s equal to 2 phi f in this equation and got VMB. If I put psi s equal to 2 phi f plus nt phi t in this equation, will I get VHB?
No, sir. Because
why?
There we have to consider the exponential term.
You are very, very attentive. I must say that. Yes. The exponential term will be present. So that is very common mistake students do, that they use the same equation. If you are talking with somebody else, can you please mute your microphone? I think it is disturbing everybody. You're most welcome in participating in this class. If you're talking with somebody else, please mute your mic. Okay, absolutely right. And this equation which you have will be carrying another term, which is the exponential term, very much present there. But this is a very common mistake students do. They use the same equation for VHB also. This is given in slide 25. For psi s greater than 2 phi f, the exponential term cannot be neglected anymore. However, psi s also shows a saturation behavior. That is, as VGB increases, psi s tends to flat out. Why do you think it is so? Mathematically.
Because the depth of the depletion.
Can you look at this equation in slide 23 and explain when psi s becomes greater than 2 phi f, why does psi s increase, slows down and almost flats out with VGB? The answer you already gave. It is because of the exponential dependence.
Exponential.
Yes. So a little change in this factor can take a large amount of change in VGB. Do you agree?
Yes.
It is a mathematical manifestation. Therefore, when psi s becomes greater than 2 phi f, only this term apparently dominates. Rest all terms become inconsequential and becomes exponential behavior. This gave rise to something known as pinning assumption, another very important assumption, where psi s is assumed to get pinned. Pinned, what does it mean, pinned? Pin means fixed at a constant value. And that constant value is taken to be 2 phi f plus nt phi t. Nt is a Civitas factor, typically 4 to 6. Phi t is 26 millivolt at room temperature. So that number is roughly 100 to 150 millivolt. Note that nt is a fuzzy parameter, which may range between 2 to 8. And the typical range, I did a lot of simulation in my early days in 90s when I was continuously in touch with Civitas. And the way we modeled that with that lesson vacuum and other, that time there was another software called Minimos, M-I-N-I-M-O-S. You must not have heard of it. Old prehistoric software, which used to model and simulate MOS devices. It was a two-dimensional program and used to take a very long time because the computer was not that powerful. I'm talking about 90s, which is almost 30 years back. And that time, after extensive simulation, we found for common levels of substrate doping Na and oxide thickness Dox, the range is typically lying between 2 and 8. I again request you, if you are not participating in the discussion, can you please mute your mic? He is not even listening to this. Okay, now this fuzzy parameter NT creates an uncertainty in threshold voltage, and VHP, which is defined as VGB equal to psi s equal to phi zero. This is, people thought this is my threshold voltage. However, look at the term phi zero there. Here we have taken into account the exponential term also, because psi s minus 2 phi f is NT phi t, and it is divided by phi t. So I got exponential NT left. So it becomes VFP plus phi zero plus gamma square root of phi zero plus phi t exponential NT. This was supposed to be the expression for threshold voltage as per Sevenis. But this is not unique, because it depends on the value of phi zero. And this phi zero depends on the value of NT. And NT does not have a fixed value, it has a range. Are you getting what I'm saying? This uncertainty is actually creating the uncertainty in threshold voltage, which is still now present. People has not been able to evaluate the exact value of threshold voltage, which sometimes comes to an advantage. If some model is not very well defined, it gives a playing field, which you will see. I hope I can finish my lectures in 3 lectures. Anyway, so this is the plot, slide 26, which is psi s versus VGB, the red line. It is really a brilliant plot. And actually, this is the one which opened lots of windows in MOS modeling. First of all, your x-axis is VGB. If you know who is talking, can you please request him to turn off his mic?
Please, can you mute Varun's?
How to do that? I'm not very conversant with this.
Sir, in the participant, you can mute. You can click the Varun's cursor.
How to do that?
In the participant.
Yeah, I have gone to participant.
Yogesh sir, message kiya. Sir, in the chat window, you can see his name, Varun Kakar, and you can mute from there.
No, but acha mute all mein, to main bhi mute ho jayenge.
No, sir.
In the participant, yes, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Now we can hear.
Yeah, thank God.
No, it is good, sir.
Because it was disturbing. Now, if you want to talk, you turn on your mic and talk to me, okay? Yeah, yes, because it was a constant irritation, because he is not even aware. I don't really mind, because this is something, it is your wish to attend it or not. There is no hard and fast rule or anything like that.
Thank you,
but
sir.
Participating, coming in and then talking to somebody else, I think what is the use? So anyway, this is an XY plot of psi s versus VGB. This plot is very, very important. Suppose my VGB equal to VFP. Look at the arrow. When VGB equal to VFP, I am at flat band, which means my psi s equal to zero. All right. Now I'm going back to my equation. Okay. This equation, because when psi s less than 2 phi f, this is my equation. When psi s is very small, this gamma is body effect coefficient, which is a number less than 1. So this number will be very, very tiny. So when psi s is near zero and positive, do you see VGB versus psi s relation is a straight line?
Yes, sir.
And as psi s grows, then this term also starts to play a role. So the rate of increase of psi s with VGB slows down. That means the curve will start to change slope. That is, it will bend down kind of thing. And eventually when the exponential terms start to become important, then it almost becomes flat. That is why we actually call the device modelers, call this equation, call this plot a golden plot. And the whole effort is to get an analytical model. You can try it out. Maybe something we are missing out, which you can figure out very easily how to do that. Can you do a single equation fit of this equation? Analytical. If you can do that, I think you'll immediately get a paper and somebody may think about Nobel Prize for you. I'm not joking. I mean, people just could not do a best fit, which is analytical, of this particular line. So what they did, they fitted the, sometimes my arrow is disappearing. Here it is. I can model this part very easily. I can model this part very easily. Problem comes right here when it is the knee region. Modeling of the knee region is very difficult. When psi s becomes equal to phi f, I get VGB equal to VLB. That is the boundary between depletion and weak inversion. When psi s becomes equal to 2 phi f, then VGB becomes VMB. That is the boundary between weak inversion and moderate inversion. The different inversion zones, regions are given in the bottom of the slide. After that, the fun starts because the flattening out becomes very severe. And there is a factor phi zero, which is 2 phi f plus nt phi t. What is that phi zero? Nobody knows, by the way. And if I say, because this phi zero, see, this is a horizontal line. But where does it cut this red line? It can cut here. It can cut here. It can cut here, 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 anywhere. And that will change my number because it is an exponential function of nt. Getting me what I'm saying? If this equation for VHB, it is an exponential function of nt. So therefore, that creates a huge havoc, a huge mess in this equation. Is that you really have a problem in modeling this accurately? Okay. Next is we move on to the next slide, which is slide number 27. The threshold voltage VT is seen to lie close to VHB for a two-terminal gate and body switch.
Hello.
Yes.
So please explain back equation VHP is equal to VGB. Please explain, re-explain.
This one, this particular equation?
Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, this is the equation. Okay, let me go back. Let's take this equation.
Yes, sir.
Put psi s equal to phi zero. Because I'm trying to find VHP now. So it will become VFP plus phi zero. Plus gamma, square root of phi zero, plus phi t, exponential, phi zero, minus 2 phi f by phi t. Phi zero is actually 2 phi f plus nt phi t. So 2 phi f cancels out. And you have got nt phi t divided by phi t. So you get phi t exponential nt, no? VFP plus phi zero plus gamma square root of phi zero plus phi t exponential nt.
Yes, sir.
Clear?
Yes, sir.
Good. So this is the equation in slide 25, the last equation. VFP plus phi zero plus gamma square root of phi zero plus phi t exponential nt. Now, if this equation I had explicitly specific value for phi zero, my job is done. Because then that will give me VHB exactly, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now move on to the next slide. The threshold voltage VT is seen to lie close to VHB for a two-terminal gate body structure. For a MOSFET having four terminals, that is source and drain, along with gate and body, psi s needs to be replaced by psi s plus VCB. Because when you have a four-terminal device, when you have source and drain also, along with the gate and body, then the source and drain will alter something known as channel potential. Okay, this needs a little bit of explanation. Psi s is measured with respect to body. This is very confusing. Be with me, because some of you are seeing it for the first time, I think. Psi s is measured with respect to body because I'm developing a body reference model, as a matter of fact, because body reference model are very, very easy because it is robust, symmetric and everything. Source reference model is actually a derivative of body reference model. If I understand body reference model well, I can switch over to source reference model anytime. But vice versa is not true. From a source reference model, going to a body reference model is very tough. But getting a body reference model and from there getting a source reference model is very easy. That is what we are trying to attempt. So when you have a four-terminal device, then I have source and drain terminal, and there is a body terminal. When my VDS is equal to zero, then my VSB and VDB are equal. And my psi s is measured with respect to body. When VDS equal to zero, the channel potential will be uniform throughout. Last class, we talked about that. However, when I have a VDS applied, then the channel potential will keep on changing. On the source side, it will be VSB. On the drain side, it will be VDB. Have you followed till this point? because all the potentials are referred with respect to body.
Yes, sir.
So when source and drain both were at zero potential, then the VSB and VDB were equal. They don't have to be zero potential, by the way. They have to be equal, so that VD is equal to zero. All right. If VD is equal to zero, VS and VBD can be anything, but they have to be equal for VDS equal to zero. Do you agree?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Now, in that case, VSB and VDB will be equal to each other. And the channel will be at equipotential. You remember we said the channel will be flat when VD is equal to zero, and the channel will tilt when VDS is non-zero. That is what is explained here. Now, when I have a VDS applied, then my source body voltage is VSB, but my drain body voltage is VDB, with the difference is VDS between the two ends. This is known as channel potential, VCB. And the surface potential does not remain at psi s anymore. Because of the applied drain source voltage, the channel potential with respect to body becomes psi s plus VCB. Total band bending. Total band bending goes up actually from psi s to psi s plus VCB, where VCB is channel potential with respect to body. Traditionally and classically, VT is defined as VGS required to make psi s equal to 2 phi f at source end. This is what we talked about in last class, the definition of threshold voltage. And for that case, VCB will be equal to VSB, because I'm defining my threshold voltage at the source end, right? VCB equal to VSB. Then with this slide, we'll be taking a small break of 5 minutes, and then we'll meet again after this slide gets over, because next is the plot. VGB equal to VGS plus VSB. I'm using potential chain rule, because if I know VGB, then I can write VGS plus VSB equal to VGB. Then VFB, VGS plus VSB, I'm writing now the VFB equation. VGB equation. VGB equation was, this is still in weak inversion or depletion or moderate inversion region. That is VFB plus psi s plus gamma root psi s. Okay? VFB plus psi s plus gamma root psi s. And now psi s is 2 phi a plus VSB. So I'm writing it as VFB plus 2 phi a plus VSB plus gamma into square root of 2 phi a plus VSB. And the threshold voltage VT is defined as VGS. So what I do in the top equation, in this equation, I'm writing VGS as VT. So VGB minus VSB is my VGS. And so in this equation, I just need to take out this VSB term out. This VSB will disappear from here. And you get VT equal to VFB plus 2 phi F plus gamma root 2 phi F plus VSB. This is the golden classical equation of threshold. This equation I gave you last class. I do not know whether you understood. What I'm doing here is onset of strong inversion, I'm defining as 2 phi F plus VCB. That VCB, since I'm defining at source end, that VCB is VSB. And then, since it is still at that range, I'm saying my exponential term is still not dominant, because you have to remember that exponential term is multiplied by phi t, which is a small number. So I am still using my equation of VFP plus psi s plus gamma root psi s. And now my psi s at inversion or threshold is 2 phi a plus VSB. That is a substitution I'm making. Psi s equal to 2 phi a plus VSB. So it becomes VFP plus 2 phi a plus VSB plus gamma square root of 2 phi a plus VSB. I think now it is understood. And VGB also is equal to VGS plus VSB. So now if I cancel these two VSB, I get VGS equal to the rest of the terms. And that VGS got to be my threshold. That is how we arrive at the classical threshold voltage equation. This can be also written as VTO plus gamma square root of 2 phi F plus VSB minus square root of 2 phi F. Where VTO is defined as VT at VSB equal to zero, which is known as zero back bias threshold voltage. All these things are familiar to you, right? You have seen all these things before. If not in device course, you must have seen it in a circuit course.
Yes, sir.
Because these equations are very frequently used when you do circuit calculation, right? The threshold voltage change with body bias. This equation must be very familiar. And VTO is a zero back bias. That is when VSB equal to zero, we say zero back bias, then this whole term vanishes and VT becomes equal to VTO. Or you can turn your mic when you want to talk. I have to mute because again noise is coming. So this change in VT with VSB is known as the body effect, which is a function of gamma. The second term is a function of gamma, body effect coefficient. By the way, that is why it is called body effect coefficient, because it tells you the change in threshold with respect to back bias. And VSB can be either zero or positive because the source body junction should never become forward biased. That is one of the severe drawbacks, because in this equation, VSB can only be zero or positive, which means VT can only be equal to VTO or greater than VTO. That is what is written here. VT is greater than equal to VTO. I have no way to make VT less than VTO, unfortunately. So what I do, I'll take a 5-minute break here and I'll meet again a little later, okay? Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, should we start now? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, move on. So the next plot is the threshold voltage versus VSB. It's a very, very interesting plot. You have a line, red line, green line, and blue line. And this actually goes up with increasing Na antiox because gamma is proportional to root Na antiox. That is, if I increase the substrate doping and oxide thickness, the body effect coefficient goes up. And higher gamma will obviously lead to a greater change of Vt with VSB. The expression without VSB, that is VSB equal to zero, is VAP plus 2 phi F plus gamma root 2 phi F. So as gamma goes up, that zero value, that is the threshold voltage at zero value also goes up as gamma goes up. And also the slope also increases, you can see that. That means the change behavioral dependence of threshold with back bias becomes very dominant or marked if my gamma value is very large. That is one of the drawback of having very large value of gamma. Very small value of gamma also has adverse consequence. So there is a rule of thumb used in technology that gamma value is typically kept between 0.1 and 1. By the way, any of you know what is the unit of gamma? You must have used it in circuits.
Voltage inverse.
Voltage to the power half, right? Because it is multiplying gamma root psi s is volts, which psi s root psi s is volt to the power half. So gamma got to be volt to the power half. So the typical value of gamma, which is kept in technology, is 0.1 to 1 volt to the power half, with typical value, which is very highly used, is 0.4 volt to the power half. When you use analog circuits, you typically try to keep the value in the range of 0.3 to 0.5, with 0.4 being the median value. There are some questions came. In strong inversion, VDB equal to zero. What does it mean? Why should strong inversion VDB equal to zero? I did not understand the question. VDB is an independent variable, right? Why should it be zero? Can you clarify the question? The question was, in strong inversion, is VDB equal to zero?
Sir, in the channel, you said that channel potential, which is nothing but VCB, is equal to VSB minus VDB. Is it correct or not?
No, channel potential VCB is changing along the channel. At the source side, it is VSB. At the drain side, it is VDB. Because it is the potential of the channel with respect to body.
So the strong inversion, what voltage we have to consider the VSB? What is the VSB value in the strong inversion?
Whatever bias you apply. Because VD, VS, VG, VB, these four are under your control. Yeah, as an user, you can use any value you want. But depending on the value of VSB which you use, your threshold will change. Because threshold is defined at the source end. Maybe I'm not getting the exact question which you're asking. VSB, VDB, VGB, all three are independent variables.
Okay. Then, yes, sir.
Okay. So only thing is VDB has to be greater than VSB, by the way, because drain has to be at a higher potential than source. No?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Maybe I did not understand or didn't answer. Okay. Now we go to the current voltage model. This course is very cramped because Yogesh wants me to talk everything about MOS modeling in four and a half hours, which is impossible. It is a full course. And I don't want to rush, because that does not make, but a lot of things will be left out, I'm sure. I'll not be able to cover it in 4.5 hours, no way. But I'll try till whatever point I go without losing you guys.
Sir,
pardon me?
Sir, which book we should refer for this?
You can refer to my book. You can refer to Civitas. You can refer to Shure. you can refer to Z. There is a reference list at the end of this presentation, and there are lots of books. And basically, whatever I'm covering, I've taken from my book only. So all the figures and etc. are from my book straight away.
Thank you, sir.
Development of a simple source referenced current voltage model, which is very popular. And I will actually, since time is not there, I will skip some parts from now onwards, because I have large number of slides. And this lecture is already 5:15. So let me see. First of all, without panicking, and like syllabus khatam karna hai, aisa nahi hai. So we just see how much we can do. A cross-sectional view again, and now we have a gate source voltage which is beyond the threshold. So I have a channel formation, and then I have my source and drain on the two sides. My source is grounded, body is grounded. I don't have to, by the way. I can apply any potential at source, any potential at body, provided source-body junction remains reverse biased. And the drain voltage I've applied is VDS. Since source is ground, whatever voltage I apply in the drain terminal is my VDS. Do you agree to that?
Yes, sir.
Because source is ground, so VDS, VD is equal to VDS, and VG equal to VGS, and VB and VS both are zero. So VB is equal to zero. This does not have any body effect. Now a very quick question. There are two lines drawn. One is the inversion channel, which is like a wedge. Is a straight line going from left to right. And then in the bottom, we have the depletion boundary. And we can see that as I'm moving from source to drain, the depletion boundary is increasing. Why is it so?
Reverse biasing, due to reverse biasing.
We talked about that in last class, right? So yeah. Part of it is done. So basically, this is what is happening. Another very interesting thing is that there is a gate voltage. Listen very carefully. Because I cannot do all the maths. The gate voltage is present, VGS. The drain voltage is present, VDS. VDS is actually creating something known as lateral field across the channel. That is, along the X direction. The coordinate system is given at the bottom of the slide, this XY you see. So X is along the channel and Y is perpendicular to the channel, into the bulk. So the voltage VDS which I apply is creating a lateral field in the channel. Question is, which way this lateral field is? Right to left or left to right in
right
this
to
line?
Left,
right
to left.
Drain to source.
Beautiful. Drain to source. Now, if that is the direction of the field, which way electrons will go?
Opposite direction.
Left to right.
Left to right.
Left to right.
Because they have negative charge, which means, is it obvious that the electrons will leave the drain terminal? Electrons will flow out of the drain terminal?
No.
What is taking you time for this answer? Electrons are moving from source to drain. They have to exit, right?
Yes, sir.
So they will move out of the drain terminal. Does it explain why ID shown in the diagram is flowing down?
Yes, sir.
Opposite direction of the moment of electron.
So that is my direction of drain current ID.
Yes, sir.
This is the model we are trying to develop. And since we have already explained in last class that since depletion region width or thickness or charge, whatever, increasing with X, therefore my inversion charge will decrease with X. Because point by point, I must have charge balance between the gate and the substrate, right? That is from charge balance. We talked about that in last class. Now, gate voltage creates something known as vertical field along Y. And VDS creates a lateral field along minus X. I repeat, the gate body voltage creates a vertical field pointing downward. Do you agree?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
And VDS creates a lateral field along minus X. Look at my direction, X.
Yes, sir.
This is my direction, X. So the VDS is applying a field along minus X, which means now I have a two-dimensional field pattern present in this device. One is vertical field due to gate, and one is lateral field due to drain. Now problem becomes quite acute. The reason is, if I have two fields present in my structure, what will be the consequence of that?
Scattering of carriers.
It is a very difficult question, actually. Suppose in a semiconductor, I have a two-dimensional field present. Then what is the consequence of that?
Scattering of carriers.
Scattering of the carriers.
Say it again.
Scattering of the carriers.
Okay. Actually, what happens is, are you familiar with Poisson equation?
Yes, sir.
What is it?
Delta V equal to minus rho by
R. If I go one step back, I get Gauss law. So when you have a two-dimensional field pattern present in my device, then I have to actually use two-dimensional Gauss equation. That is del Ex del X plus del Ui del Y equal to rho by epsilon. So the problem immediately becomes two-dimensional problem, because my electric field is bidirectional. One is vertical, one is lateral. Yes, there I can say it is a resultant field will matter, but I can make an approximation by which I can neglect one field completely. And that gives a rise to a second assumption, which we'll make very, very soon. There is one assumption I've already seen, charge sheet assumption, with which we started today. There is another vital assumption we need to make to proceed forward, and which is known as gradual channel approximation. Some of you must have heard of it, gradual channel approximation. Based on these two assumptions, MOSFET modeling is based. One is charge sheet assumption, the other one is gradual channel approximation. Let's move on to next slide, which is slide number 31. If I assume VGS greater than VT and small VDS, then I have a two-dimensional field. One is gate to body along Y, which you call EY due to VG, and drain to source along minus X, which you call EX, which is due to VD. So now I have a two-dimensional field pattern, and I have to, if I want to know my charge, then I have to solve two-dimensional potential, Gauss law, which I do not want to do. So I make another very important assumption known as gradual channel approximation, or GCA. What is this GCA? This is second vital approximation. It says rate of change of lateral field EX much smaller than that of vertical field EY. That is del EX del X much, much less than del EY del Y. This is a very important assumption. That is, I'm assuming that the vertical field change with respect to Y is much greater than lateral field change with respect to X. One word of caution, it is not EX much less than EY. It is del EX del X much less than del EY del Y. And the reason behind that is del EX del X and del EY del Y appear in the Gauss law, because it says gradient of electric field is charge, right? Charge divided by permittivity. That is why it is not the absolute field that matters, but rate of change. As a matter of fact, in modern devices, this gradual channel approximation breaks down completely. And therefore, so many new modeling approaches have evolved, because in modern devices, the channel length we are talking about only maybe 3 to 5 nanometers or even less. And your potential applied is very large, typically several volts. Then the lateral field is very large. The gradient also is very large. And in that case, I cannot use the gradual channel approximation. All right. Move on. The channel potential VCS changes linearly from zero at source end to VDS at drain end. See, I again have changed my reference. In the earlier slide, I was talking about VCB. If you're not attentive, it is very, very confusing, because this is one of the topic which I think is toughest, the MOS modeling. And teaching this course also is very tough, because you have to be extremely focused and concentrated, and audience has to be concentrated too. Because there are so many manipulations happening. So far, we are talking about VSB, VDB, VCB, etc. Now we are changing to something known as channel potential VCS of X, which is referred with respect to source. The second coefficient, letter, previously it was VCB, now it is VCS, through which I have cleverly change my reference to source because I'm trying to model the source reference model. VCS of X changes linearly from zero at source end to VDS at drain end. See how beautifully previously it was VSP and VDB because both were respect to body. But now if I refer to those potentials with respect to source, then the potential of source with respect to source is zero.
Yes, sir.
Potential of source with respect to potential of a terminal with respect to that terminal is zero. And potential of drain with respect to source is VDS. Source referenced model means all my potentials will be referred to with respect to source. That is, I want to develop a model in terms of VGS and VDS. VT is already source referenced. Are you seeing the logic?
Yes, sir.
VGS with respect to source, VDS with respect to source, VT defined at source end. So everything is becoming consistent. And this wedge shape which you have in the inversion charge, by simple capacitor model, we can write this expression for QI prime, which you are seeing in this slide, this expression. This QI prime as a function of X, this is again Q equal to CV equation, charge equal to capacitance into voltage. It is minus COX prime into VGS minus VT minus VCS of X. If you don't understand, I'll tell you a trick how to understand this. Let's take X equal to zero. X equal to zero means source end. Listen very carefully. At source end, my VCS of X is zero.
Yes, sir.
Then I have QI prime at source end is minus COX prime into VGS minus VT. VGS minus VT is the driving force of this inversion charge. We assume at threshold, it is zero. And after that, it is changing linearly. This is linearized model of QI, which is very popular. And it actually works out very well for quick hand calculation that VGS minus VT is my inversion charge at the source end. Now, if I want to include the effect of the drain voltage, I just subtract VCS from this. That's all I do. Because all these terms note that they are referred with respect to source. VGS with source, VT with respect to source, VCS with respect to source. This is actually a parallel plate capacitor equation. Gate and channel assumed to be two plates of capacitor. And note that gate is at equipotential because it is a metal, but channel potential is changing with position. This is a very, very important point. Another interesting point is, suppose I make my VCS of X variable. Listen very carefully, you know the result. And I put X equal to L, let's say X equal to L, that means my drain end. What is VCS of X at drain end?
VDS.
And if I put QI prime at L, that is my drain end, equal to zero, then do you see the value of VDS I need to do that? Sorry. The value of VDS I need to do that is VGS minus VT?
Yes, sir.
Does it ring a bell?
Yes, sir.
What is it?
Saturation drain voltage.
Ah, absolutely. That is the voltage needed to pinch off channel at drain end. This model brings it out beautifully. This parallel plate capacitor model for inversion charge. That QI prime as a function of X is equal to minus COX prime into VGS minus VT minus VCS of X. This brings out the physics beautifully. As a matter of fact, since I've assumed, if you look at the first line of this slide, that the channel potential is changing linearly, then QI prime should also change linearly. Look at the plot. Here also, this inversion charge line is a straight line, changing linearly with position. One caution though, that this diagram has a huge error, purposely kept, by the way. Can you detect what error? The question is not easy. The answer also is very difficult. But for that, you have to have a deep understanding. Oh, once I tell you the answer, you will say we knew that because it is obvious. But from this diagram, can you figure out that this diagram is actually highly erroneous?
The depletion region is not varying linearly. The inversion region is varying linearly. So
okay, one. Possibly true, yes. Because if inversion charge varies linearly, so should depletion charge. Good point. Anything else? Any other blatant error? You won't be able to say that because it is a very deep question. Depletion region, listen very carefully, because these are the insights I want to give instead of just routinely talking about the slides I have, because these insights we lack. Depletion charge is contained within the depletion region. Have you done any PN junction numerical calculation? In diodes, have you done any numerical calculation? Can you tell me what is the rough thickness of a depletion region in a PN junction diode? Roughly, the order of magnitude. In a normal PN junction diode, what is the typical thickness of the depletion region?
In micrometer?
Very good. Absolutely. Micron. It is typically micron to tens of micron, something like that. Micrometer, eh? Keep this number stored in your memory. That is the depletion charge. This line and above that is my inversion layer, right? Here. Inversion layer is constituted of what?
Electrons.
Electrons.
Conducting region.
Electrons. So I have a sheet charge of electrons at the surface, right? Followed by the depletion region. What do you think is the typical width or the depth of the inversion channel?
It's 5 to 10 nanometer.
5 to 10?
Nanometer.
Very good. Very good. Absolutely correct number. It is typically 50 to 100 angstrom. Why, by the way? Why it is so small?
Because the applied gate voltage pulls it to the surface.
Yes, another reason. Think about
because the ions are like here, depletion are ions are like, they are like atoms. Their size is large, but here inversion layer, we are having electrons. So their size is...
I think, sir, the doping concentration is much less than the...
Sir, because they are because of the minority
concentration
carrier.
Of the charge carrier.
No, I think the answer was given right now. I cannot
doping
detect.
Concentration. Doping concentration is less than that of the carrier,
sir,
concentration.
The inversion charge
is less than the bulk concentration.
I think one of you said the right answer, but I'm not able to pick up the names.
Yes, sir. The inversion charge is because of the minority carrier concentration.
The doping concentration is less than the
doping concentration has nothing to do with it. What is it? The answer came, which is correct answer. Is the inversion channel is constituted of electrons.
Yes.
And depletion charge is constituted of ions.
Ions.
They are a huge order of magnitude difference in their dimension. Which means if in a diagram I show the depletion boundary, in the same diagram, I cannot so show the inversion boundary. Do you agree?
No.
Because let me finish. Because one thickness is of the order of 100 angstrom. The other one is about 1000 nanometer. So in the same diagram, I possibly cannot put both. If I put the depletion boundary, my inversion boundary I cannot show. And if I put the inversion boundary in my diagram, my depletion boundary will be way out of this slide. Where, I don't know. Because their dimensional difference is huge. Actually, people do not refer to these salient points when they write book, that this diagram is an artistic view, a representative view. This is not the actual picture. Because, another example I can give you, which is similar to this, is when you plot the IV relation of a diode. You know, in the forward direction, you show it exponentially going up. And then you go down and then make it saturated. And you show both of them in the same diagram. Do you realize you cannot do that? Because in diode, forward current is typically of the order of milliampere. On the other end, the reverse current is of the order of picoampere, nanoampere, femtoampere, things like that. How can you put both in the same scale? The same thing is applicable here. The inversion channel, if I drew it correctly, it will be just the interface. That's it. I possibly couldn't have shown this variation.
Hello?
Yes.
सर इन डिप्लिक्शन साइड पे जो लेयर होगी तो उसमें इलेक्ट्रॉन और आयंस का जो ये डिफरेंस है ये क्यों होता है ऐसा मतलब ये सा हैपनिंग क्यों होती है इधर लेयर पे
बिकॉज़ इलेक्ट्रॉन्स आर पुल्ड अप ना बाय द एस वन आंसर केम दैट इलेक्ट्रॉन्स आर पुल्ड अप बाय द गेट फील्ड आयंस कैन नॉट मूव आयंस आर फिक्स्ड इन द लैटिस आयंस हैव फॉर्म बॉन्ड्स दे आर फिक्स्ड इन द लैटिस रिमेंबर लास्ट क्लास वी टॉक्ड अबाउट मोबाइल चार्जेस एंड इमोबाइल चार्जेस आयंस आर इमोबाइल चार्जेस दे कैन नॉट मूव So they're fixed in the lattice, but the electric field is pointing downward. So those electric field is pulling the electrons to the top surface. And that's how inversion builds up. The channel forms at the surface, not below that. And since this channel is constituted of electrons and electrons being tiny particles, the depth of this line is very, very small. So this line is almost flushed with the interface. That is why. So this diagram is technically incorrect, but all books have it. But in my book, I've attempted to bring out this point that this diagram actually you cannot do unless you put that disclaimer that I'm doing it fully well, knowing that this is a dimensional error I'm making. But to bring out the feature of the inversion channel variation with distance, we are keeping it here.
Sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir, as you said, the width of the depletion layer is in the micrometer range.
Yeah.
So in the nanometer devices, which we are doing in the research, so in that case, the bulk is completely depleted.
Yes, actually there is a device PDSOI, no? PDSOI and FDSOI, partially yes. depleted and fully depleted. Yes, there are devices. As a matter of fact, if you do not want your substrate to be completely depleted, that is why, very good point actually. As the device went to miniaturization, substrate doping kept on rising. For example, when I was a student in 80s, that time substrate doping was typically 15, 16, something like that. Nowadays, nobody talks below 18, minimum. Not only that, even 18 is not sufficient to prevent complete depletion. So what they do is ion implant. They ion implant a region below the surface so that at that particular region, I have a very high doping density. You have been exposed to ion implant, one technology? Have you heard of this term?
Yes,
sir. So by ion implantation, we can do doping. Doping can be done two ways. One is by diffusion. The other is by ion implantation. Each of them have advantages and disadvantages. But modern devices are all ion implanted. They are not diffused. Because diffusion actually spreads laterally too much. Ion implantation is directional. It goes in one particular direction. So you don't have that lateral straggle problem. That it moves out from the region where you want to dope. I do not know whether I answered your question, but the reason why this electron comes to the surface is because of the gate field.
Yes, sir, you answered this.
Yeah, I did.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, move on. So I will skip this because this is the current voltage derivation. I will come here. This equation all of us know, so let's start from here. The previous slides were the derivation of this equation, which I don't have time to do. So ID is equal to, after all said and done, this is the simplest basic model using that capacitor charge equation of QI prime, which we just mentioned, that QI prime is minus COX prime into VGS minus VT minus VCS of X. And then using that equation in the Ohm's law, I can get this equation very easily. The previous three slides have the derivation. Right now, let's go to the bottom of the matter because time is running out very rapidly. So ID is Kn into VGT into VDS minus VDS squared by 2. All of you are very familiar with this equation. And this is the current voltage model of MOSFET in linear region, we call it. several terms are defined. This is a very compact representation, by the way, because each of the terms can be expanded. For example, VGT is a very important term known as gate overdrive. Gate overdrive is defined as VGS minus VT. What it essentially says is how much VGS is greater than the threshold voltage. That is why it is called gate overdrive. Kn is defined as WIL into Kn prime, and and it is known as device transconductance parameter. Device transconductance parameter. Kn prime is defined as mu n into Cox prime, which is known as process transconductance parameter, and W by L is known as aspect ratio. I'm sure all of you know this, so I'll just give an insight. What is the difference between device transconductance parameter and process transconductance parameter? In process transconductance parameter, if you see the expression for Kn prime, it is mu n into Cox prime. Mu n is the channel electron mobility, and Cox prime is the oxide capacitance per unit area. Now, a little bit of technology, very briefly. L, W, and T, Tox rather, length, width, and oxide thickness. These are three dimensional technology parameters. That is, these technology parameters has dimension as their unit. Agree?
Yes, sir.
What is the difference between these three? Is there a difference? Maybe the question is not clear, but do you put all three in the same basket, or say, no, this one is different. It has to be put in a different basket. All are dimension, all are distance.
The thickness of the oxide.
Why? Answer is correct. Why?
Because that depends the gate coupling to the channel, as well as it has it contains the most of the charges in the oxide, which depends on this channel thickness as well. And when we're going for scaling, the most important parameter is the thickness of the oxide, which need to be
taken. Capacitance of oxide, sir.
So you are going to put Tox in a different basket?
Yes.
Yeah, there is a technology reason. Answer is correct. But the reason is slightly different. The reason is, let me tell you the answer and see whether you agree with that. L and W are defined as lateral dimension, and Tox is defined as vertical dimension. Do you agree?
Yes, sir.
L and W can be dictated by masking. When you do CAD modeling, when you do chips, when you do tape out, L and W are actually drawn on the mask because they are the opening of the channel length, channel width, etc. But Tox you cannot draw because Tox is a vertical growth.
Yes, sir.
The entire wafer is oxidized at the same time. If you tell your fab engineer that, see, one, let's say 6-inch or 12-inch wafer contains thousands of chips now, and each chip contains about billions of devices. Imagine that. Mind-boggling. Typically, the wafer diameter ranges between 8 and 12 inches right now for commercial processes. 8 to 12 inches, yes. Rokolansky method. Maybe tomorrow you have a technology lecture. Amit will tell you all about that. So 8 to 12 inches diameter, and there have thousands of chips on that. Each chip has billions of devices. And this wafer is oxidized at the same time because oxidation is a vertical thing. So when you oxidize the entire wafer. You cannot do piecewise oxidation or location-wise oxidation. You cannot do. What am I telling is that the vertical dimension is not under designer's control. The vertical dimension is under the control of fab engineer. Whatever fab engineer tells you the Tox of this wafer is such and such, you have to live with it. There is no way you can deviate from that. Therefore, once TOCs become defined by the FAB technology, immediately your KN prime gets defined, because mu n more or less is a known quantity. You already know mu n from your doping, because mu n depends on Na. So out of the four technology parameters I told you, L, W, Na, and TOX, Na and TOX, these two are defined as FAB engineer's prerogative. You have no say. You cannot go to the FAB engineer and say, can you please change Na for this particular MOSFET in this particular chip? He will just laugh it out. Are you mad? Because Na is uniform for all devices. TOX is uniform for all devices. You want to play with it? Play with L and W. That much I can give you, but nothing more. That is why KN prime, which is mu n into COX prime, are called process transconductance parameter. Is it a little more clear now?
Yes, sir.
When I multiply that by aspect ratio, it becomes device transconductance parameter, because W and L, designers can design, and they can tell the mask engineer that this is my length and width of these devices, and I can have different length and width for all devices in the chip. No problem. That's what masking does. Are you seeing the intricacy?
Yes, sir.
Now, if I say that KN prime is a constant for a wafer, but KN can change from device to device, do you agree?
Yes, sir.
Done. Move to next slide. For small VDS, VDS square term can be neglected, and ID will change linearly with VDS. I'll take another 5 minutes. I have to wrap up at least the IV model, so tomorrow we can take into account second order effects. Please stick with me for another 5 to 7 minutes. The ID changes linearly with VDS. Let me at least finish the IV model. If I look at the equation, I'm going back to slide 36 now. If I look at the IV relation, that KN into VGT into VDS minus VDS square by 2. If I take small value of VDS, then I can see ID versus VDS relation is a straight line, because VGT is a constant. I'm not changing VGS, by the way. If I don't change VGS, VGT is constant, and then ID changes linearly with VDS. As VDS increases, then this restraining factor minus reduces the rate of increase of ID with VDS. Do you agree? Because it is minus. So which means the initial slope which I have, as VDS is going up, the slope is decreasing. That is, it is trying to flat out again. And eventually, the pinch of point which we talked about, when VDS becomes equal to VGT, this gate overdrive, by the way, which is in this slide, this gate overdrive is also your drain source saturation voltage. Do you agree?
Yes, sir.
Interesting. That your gate overdrive immediately tells you what is your VDS sat or drain source saturation voltage. And once it goes there, this equation will reach a max value. If I use this equation beyond that point, it will drop again all the way to zero. That is, I get a parabola end of. So the value of ID for VDS greater than VGT is not valid for this equation. That is why this equation is known as what? This equation has a name, which is? You know.
Transfer characteristic.
No, it's called linear region equation.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yeah, linear or non-saturation.
Output characteristic.
Yeah, because MOSFET mode of operation is two. Na? One is non-saturation, the other is saturation. This is the non-saturation equation. Now, if for small VDS, VDS square term can be neglected, and ID will change linearly with VDS, and we have linear or non-saturation region. As VDS goes up, restraining effect of VDS square term goes up, and rate of increase of ID with VDS slows down. That is why the curve starts to flat out. And QI prime tends to zero as VCS of X tends to VGT. This phenomena, which I said just a few minutes earlier, is known as pinch off of the channel at the drain end. The drain end pinches first, by the way, isn't it? I cannot pinch off source before drain, right? So the pinch off will happen first at the drain end, and then it will move towards the source. And this term is known as saturation. Beyond this point, ID does not increase anymore. it saturates. If I put X equal to L at drain end, then VCS of L becomes VDS, and it is known as drain to source saturation voltage. All these things we have done, and it is a nomenclature or terminology which we use for this term is VDS sat. And VDS sat is equal to VGT. For VDS greater than VDS sat, how do I get the current? I use the linear equation, linear mode equation, and just put VDS equal to VGT. That's all I do. And then I get ID sat equals to gain by 2 VGT square. Obtained by substituting VDS equal to VDS sat equal to VGT in linear region ID equation. Do you see any striking feature in this equation? Let me go back to this linear mode equation. And now I move on to the saturation equation. Do you see any striking difference? There are two.
It does not depend on the drain voltage anymore.
Number one, note it down that in saturation, this simple model does not show any dependence on VDS. Agreed?
Yes, sir.
Good. That's point number one done. Very good. Another second point. Very good. Very good observation. Because I don't see any VDS in this equation. So my drain current becomes independent of VDS. Any other striking difference between these two equations?
ID at saturation is always getting constant.
ID in saturation?
It is constant beyond also saturation drain current. It is constant.
Because it does not have any dependence on VDS, so it becomes constant. That answer has already been given. Mm-hmm. But any other striking difference? These are the observation, right? You are researchers.
Can so you have previous
side by side. What inference you draw is very important, right?
Depend on gate or drive square function.
Louder. You are in the right direction. Tell me.
Gate or drive. My square function voltage
and
ID in saturation is depend on gate over drive as a square function
and complete. You have said one part, second part,
and KN
it is directly proportional to W by L.
And
I am saying the difference between non saturation equation and saturation equation.
And
answer is given that saturation equation is independent of VDS. Done. That is put in the basket. The second point I want.
Conductance is reduced by the factor.
Actually, the very simple thing you are missing out.
Distance is very high.
Very, very simple observations you are missing out.
And there is a factor of 1/2.
Okay, fine. Okay, let me tell you and see if you agree with me. You do not have to. But I am saying another striking difference is that if I look at the saturation current equation, my ID versus VGS is a parabola. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
If I go back to the non-saturation equation, my ID versus VGS is straight line. No?
Yes, sir.
Striking difference. The behavioral difference is huge. One is a linear function. The other one is a quadratic function. Don't you think so? That's the way it goes. Yeah, from these two equations, dependence of ID on VGS and VDS is explicit. But there is also an implicit dependence on VBS through VT. And this VT is VTO plus gamma square root of 2 phi plus VSB minus square root of 2 phi. We have seen that before. Generally VBS, let's skip that. Let's move on to gate control. Gate control, I'll take time. From gate control, I'll start tomorrow. This is the level zero model. I can finish it now. Combining all these equations, we get level zero model of MOSFET. I'll start from gate control in tomorrow's class. Tomorrow also, we are meeting at 4:15. I'll just want to show you the plot and then wrap it up today. The first one is linear region or non-saturation region, where ID is Kn into VGT into VDS minus VDS square by 2. And this is valid for VGT greater than 0 and VDS less than VGT. That is one mode, linear or non-saturation. The second mode is Kn by 2 VGT square, which is saturation. for VGT greater than zero, that is my gate source voltage got to be greater than threshold, and VDS greater than equal to VGT, that is my second mode. And the third mode is cut off when VGT is less than zero. For any VDS, I get zero current. So this is what is you have used. Some of you must have used SPICE. SPICE, have you used? PSPICE or ORCAD SPICE or HSPICE? Yes, or there are several versions of SPICE software. And I'm sure majority of you have used that. And some of you unknowingly might have used level zero model. Some packages come with model inbuilt. You don't have any way to change that. But PSPICE, you can define the model, the level number. It can go to level 7 in PSPICE. As you go up in level, you add more and more second order and third order effects. This is the current voltage characteristic. So with this, we'll wrap up today. So if I plot ID versus VDS, the red line, the green line, and the blue line are for different values of VGS, which are all greater than threshold VT. And this hyperbole which you see, VDS sat, it is VGS minus VT. That is the dotted line which is going like that. Below that, I have non-saturation region, and above that, I have saturation region. And this line, this hyperbole which you have, it actually demarcates the two regions, non-saturation and saturation. Below saturation, below this point, I have my lines going up initially as a straight line, then the slope is reducing, eventually flattening out, all plots. In the same plot, I have also shown dotted lines and marked them as actual. Why is it happening? These actual lines are different from the ideal lines. Why?
Channel length modulation.
Thank you so much. We'll talk about that tomorrow. Thank you very much. Sorry again for overrunning a little bit. And I hope to do a significant amount of second order effects tomorrow. Only wish I had some little more time to cover it in more detail. Thank you so much. Gate control will start from tomorrow. Remind me if I miss that. That is a very important point. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
I have to stop sharing the screen and then end the meeting. These are the two things I have to do. Okay, bye. Have a good evening and see you tomorrow.
Okay. Bye.